graag, hier is een hele span wat ons nou gaan inlig, klomp kennis en ervaring wat hier so is. Ek wil graag begin om vir Malcolm Moody en sy span, uit die Obaru stal uit, Malcolm samenwerken met Obaru, is dat ek wil graag net gauw een paar woorde sê rondom Malcolm. Malcolm was vir plus minus 30 jaar in die veevoerbedrijf by Molatech voere en so ook by Voermol voere. Tans is hy veeadviseer by Obaru, verantwoordelik vir veevoere, veeartsenykunde produkte en ook rouwmateriale. Hy is een van Samick, sy senior op die hoefbeoordelaars en as voorsitter van die SA Fat Stock Judging Association, waar opleiding gedoen word van die hoefbeoordelaars van karkascompetities. Ek het die voorreg gehad om verskeie kere Malcolm al te sien toesprake lever oor hierdie aspek. Het is iets wonderliks om te sien, jy mond gaan oophang, as jy hoor dat hulle vandag vir ons sê. Malcolm, baie welkom vir julle ook hier so in jou span, en ook van Obare oor die algemene, die borg en alles, en jy is welkom in die woord.
Baie dankie Willem, waardeer het geweldig. Mense, is een groot voorreg dat ons hier kan wees, Llewellyn en Corrie, baie dankie dat julle ons gevraagd. Julle doen geweldig baie vir die bedrijf. Ek wil net my span voorstel aan julle, ons het vir Rudy van die Westhuizen hier so. Hy is die CEO van Samick Suid-Afrika. Hy gaan vir jou bykie meer vertel waaroor het gaan, maar een baie belangrike man in ons bedrijf. En ons werk allemaal na die punt toe wat Samick graag wil hee, want hulle weet wat die mark daar buiten wil hee, die kliënt wil hee. Dan wil ek ook net vir Henny Gerber senior op die karkas kan, beoordelaar ook welkom hier het hier so, hy gaan vir ons die karkas te bespreek, en dan James Jeffries ook een senior beoordelaar. Het is my groot voorreg om baie jare samen te werk en hulle ook hier te hee. En dan Philip Lee is een van ons junior beoordelaars wat bezig is om ergens te kom, en ek wil net sê baie dankie aan hom ook dat hy vandag hier is. Rudy, ek gaan nou oorgee na jou toe, baie dankie vir jou tyd, waardeer het baie.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to do my best to explain to you in English to accommodate everybody here today. First of all, we are very far from the stud breed farmers. We are between the commercial farmers, communal farmers, and the consumer. So some of the things I'm going to say today maybe not in line with what you would like me to say, but I'm not here to try and please everybody, and I'm also not here to try and break your efforts down. I'm here to inform you regarding our experience, where we are, and our experience is we are in the meat industry between the farmer and the consumer. Ladies and gentlemen, there are basically three fundamental basic principles that every red meat farmer needs to understand. The one is, you need to measure to know. You need to measure to know. And I think stud breed owners, that's what they do. The second one is very important. The consumer is king. Ladies and gentlemen, you can say what you want, you can breed what you want. If the consumer don't like your product, they're not going to buy it. And the third one is genetics. So that is where the stud farmers is coming in, selling bulls to commercial farmers to ensure the necessary quality characteristics to zoom in with the national red meat classification system. This is very important, ladies and gentlemen, that you understand that we have more or less 38 different breeds in South Africa. And every breed in South Africa is there to be consumed by the consumer. But we need to understand the needs of the consumer. If we don't understand the needs of the consumer, it's not going to be fruitful to try and do your own thing and think you're right and everybody else is wrong. And I'm not saying that you are wrong. I'm saying But I'm, what I'm trying to say is that we need to understand each other. That's what I'm trying to say. Ladies and gentlemen, in South Africa, more people is born than people who die. Statistics told us that 900,000 newborns arrived every year in South Africa. In the same time, 600,000 people passed away every year. The growth of people is more or less 300,000 per year in South Africa. And I was the other day at the Redmond Outdoor Association's Congress in the Western Cape, and Professor, I forget his name for the moment, from the Northwestern University said, every 4 days there are 1 million people more on Earth. Every 4 days, 1 million people more on Earth. So, and all the people on Earth needs to eat. So what I'm trying to say is, ladies and gentlemen, is that what you do is good and right. But what we try to tell you is you must look at your consumer. That the needs of the consumer is all about what you present to them. There are 419 abattoirs registered by the Department of Agriculture, Forestry and Fisheries to slaughter beef, sheep and pork in South Africa. 419. The slaughtering figures for the previous year, on beef we have slaughtered 2,700. I'm just rounded off now. Ach, 2,700,000 cattle. Sheep, we slaughter 5,600,000. Pork, 2,700,000. And total 11 million animals were slaughtered the previous year in South Africa at the 419 registered abattoirs. Different legislation regarding abattoirs and meat. The Animal Welfare Act, that is one thing, ladies and gentlemen, which you need to understand quite well. Don't bother with welfare. If you bother with welfare, you bother with the consumer. Don't do that. The second one is the Meat Safety Act. The Meat Safety Act is the inspection of carcasses at abattoirs to guarantee that those meat are safe and wealthy to use. Third one is Agricultural Product Standards Act. That is where we come in very strongly. That is all about the classification, roller marks, and stamps on carcasses. Again, just on this point, this is a voluntary system. So some abattoirs don't use the system, but they only very few, 5% more or less, which don't use the system in South Africa of the slaughtering. It's normally the urban areas where the abattoir owner have it normally his own butchery, slaughtering at his abattoir and sell the meat from his butchery to the people in the particular area. There's the Water Act, must be clean water at all time, Pollution Act and the Health Act. That is basically the acts involved in red meat in South Africa. And by the way, I've given you the slaughtering totals. Just want to add on this one, we slaughtered 980 million chickens a year in South Africa. 980 million chickens a year in South Africa. 50% market share to our 56% market share to our 44% market share in red meat. And we imported to South Africa 230,000 tons of chicken yearly. We imported, I think I got it somewhere here. If I didn't got it, I'll tell you later. Right, consumption of red meat in South Africa. Beef, 14 kilogram per capita per year. Sheep and lamb, 2.6 kilogram per capita per year. And pork, 4.6 kilogram per capita per year. That's the consuming. The ratio, beef, 726,000 ton per year, representing 68%. Sheep, 135,000 ton per year, representing 13%. And pork, 200,000 ton per year, representing 19%. Here we have it. Right. Importation of meat, currently 230,000 ton of chicken is coming in. 30,000 ton of pork is coming in. 13,000 ton of beef is coming in. And 7,000 ton of mutton and lamb is coming in this country every year. at this particular moment. All right, let's talk about the quality system, South African red meat classification system. That is where we come in very strongly. And each of you hopefully have an A4 page in front of you with the red meat classification system on it. You can follow me on that one while I'm talking about it for you to understand now what is the classification system is all about. And when you get the practical demo, you will have a basic background about the classification system when the practical demo is gonna take place. South African red meat classification system provides a sound basis for meat traders to describe their specific requirements in simple terms when purchasing carcasses. Utilization of variety in the market with a view of optimum consumer satisfaction, very important. Utilization of price differences and also determining selling prices. The aims of the red meat classification system are to encourage the production of high quality red meat in with regard to the market needs. On that one, ladies and gentlemen, I just want to, and I don't want to step on toes, I just want to put it to you. For stud farmers, maybe a challenge for the future. When we look at your cuts there, which you have with you, the money is lying in the loin, the rump and loin. That's where the money is lying. And if I can discuss it here, just very basically, quickly. Inside here, we have the fillet, which is 1% of the carcass. Here we have the rump. The rump is from there to there. This is the rump. And here we have the loin. That's the loin. Okay. So what we need in South Africa, ladies and gentlemen, and I'll tell you why I'm saying that, we need longer loins. That's one thing. The other thing is we need the rumps to become bigger, and we need longer fillets. That's what we need. The loin is the most important part of the carcass because that is where the price is. Fillets is going between 120 and 250 rand a kilogram. Rump is going between 85 and 125 rand per kilogram. And loin is going between 85 and 125 per kilogram. That's where the money is lying in carcasses. Say again?
Can we select for bigger fillets? Seems that's the most expensive.
Well, I would like to ask the stud farmers to look at length.
And then you will get bigger fillets too?
You can have the fillets for 200 rand a kilo, yes.
Yes, but if we can select for bigger fillets, because that's the most expensive part.
Most expensive part, it's only 1% of the carcass, unfortunately. Okay, so ladies and gentlemen, that is one thing from our side, which we would like to tell you today, is in the stud farming business, we need to look at rump and loins, which including the fillet. That's what we need to look at. Because every abattoir nowadays is busy building already built a deboning plant. We're going away from hindquarters to cuts, primal cuts. The market is going all the way to primal cuts nowadays. And if you have a primal cut where you have a longer loin, you will have more weight and more money. A longer fillet, more weight, no, more money. The same with the rump. That's what we should strive to go for, is for that. We are exporting at this particular moment much more meat than you think today. The market is open. In the East, we haven't got EU status. For a simple reason, 85% of our meat is hormones, growing hormones, and also Zolmax, and EU don't want it. But we have very vast markets going open now in the eastern part of the world. So we're exporting a lot of primal cuts, especially loins, especially fillets, and especially rumps to the eastern countries in the world, much more than you think. But what the guys which export told me is that it's not necessary that they make more money, because the cost to get it there is very expensive. But they make more or less the same money. But the main thing is they are able to slaughter more now, which means that the unit's cost is coming down in the abattoirs. That is what it means. And that's good for them and good for everybody. The next one is to demonstrate the classification system and the advantage thereof to producers. And that's what we're going to do today. To demonstrate to producers that the described carcass characteristics are visible on live animals. Malcolm is going to do it on a live animal for you in time to come now, just after my speech is finished. And there you will understand why we say the classification demonstrate to you where and what to look at. The classification characteristics of beef, lamb, sheep and goat meat. First of all, we have four age classes. The first one in the A class, and that is purple roller marks on carcasses, means no permanent teeth. No permanent teeth. That's what it means. No permanent teeth. Not no teeth. There are teeth like babies. Get born without teeth, and later they get milk teeth, and then it fall out and get permanent teeth. And per definition, we call it most tender. Most tender. Then on the AB class, which is a green roller mark, there we have between one and two permanent teeth. And that's front teeth on the lower jaw. Then on the B class, which is brown roller mark, between three and six permanent teeth, and then more than six permanent teeth is red roller mark, and that is in the C class. Definitions on the A, most tender, AB, tender, B, less tender, and C, least tender. We never talk about tough meat. We talk about less tender, least tender. Because that's the reason why we don't want to discriminate against that meat, because when you use most moist heat cooking methods, then B and C class meat is much more tastier than A and AB class meat. But for dry heating purposes, A and AB, that's the thing to go for. Fat classes, we have seven fat classes. I'm going to go through it by definition. No fat means no visible fat on the carcass. No visible fat on the carcass. Then very lean means less than 1 millimeter fat spread over the carcass. The two coat is lean. That means between 1 and 3 millimeter fat spread over the carcass. And this is the most popular fat you can get in South Africa. It's a lean, by definition, two fat coat. That is what the consumer wants. That's what they want. They want fat. There's nobody which say we don't want fat. They want fat, but very little. Because if you're gonna prepare meat which have no fat, it's gonna be really, it's not gonna be a pleasure, it's gonna be dry. Then medium, the free coat is also acceptable for the consumer, but not as much as the lean, the two coat. The fifth one is four coat, is fat. The consumer tends to move away, don't like it very much. Getting to the five fat coat, slightly over fat, consumer don't want it. And getting to the six fat coat, excessively over fat, don't want it. So you need to ensure that the consumer get between a two and a three, but 80% of South African consumers will tell you we want lean fat, and that is a two fat. Conformation on carcasses. This is very, very important especially for deboning plants, where you would like to have less bone, more meat. And there we have very flat, that is a carcass which you can see a lot of bones coming out, and not acceptable for the market. The flat, the two coat is also not a very acceptable for the market, because still too much bone, and according to the meat percentage. From the medium onwards is acceptable. three, it's, four is round and five is very round. Now, very little carcasses will be very round. We don't see them often. But that is actually that is the ultimate to go for. Because then you will have more or less 13% bone. The rest will be meat. On a round four round confirmation, 15% bone, 85% meat. Medium coming down to 18% and then over 20 with one and two. That's the difference, ladies and gentlemen. So we need to look at the confirmation of carcasses, and that is genetics. That's what it is. Damage coach, what we have here is for instance, say for instance, here's a bruising on this carcass, and we need to cut it out. If it's only on, so that you can see it, you cut it away, it will be only slightly. But if it's deeper into the muscle, then it's moderate. But if it's deeper up until the bone, this is severe. And those carcasses get penalized by the buyer. If you cut a piece out of the rump here, you're going to lose money on your carcass. That's it. And also on the loin, the same thing is going to happen. So that's why we have those coats to indicate to the buyer what are you buying. If there's damage, you must know about it. And if you want to pay less for that damage, then it's your right to do that. Then on the sixth part, the carcass of a ram or a bull, as well as a hommel, a carpater or an ox, showing signs of light castration of the A, B, B and C age class are identified. Because what we have there is, you can have a taste difference, you can have a color difference, and you can have a smell difference. And for that reason, that's why we put the MD stamp on it. And the MD stamp is black ink, which means it's negative. And it will be downgraded because of that. But not in the on the A-class, because A-class animals is not matured enough to produce calves and lambs and those. When we look at the stamp marks, you have your page with you there. Just have a look there. There's your age stamps. You can see the A there in purple, A, B in green, B in brown, and the C in red. And the fat coats, there the fat goes from 0 to 6. That is how the stamp look like. When we look at confirmation, that is how the stamp look like a star. And there's an example of a free confirmation. And also where we put it on the carcass is there. And there we have the damage stamps. One which is slightly is brown. Two which is red start indicating some severe some damage which can count against the carcass. And three which is black. A black stamp is a negative stamp, always. There's the MD stamp, black stamp, will be discriminated against the carcass. In the case of a sheep carcass with a fat tail, a double impression of the stamp will be on the carcass to indicate to you that you're going to buy a fat tail, which means that the rump part of that lamb or mutton carcass will have a lot of fat. Damage, if it occurs, is indicated on a scale of 1 to 3 for the areas concerned. It can be on the buttock, it can be on the loin, or it can be on the forequarter. We indicate where for the buyer to know where the damage is occurred and what will he be prepared to pay for that. Examples of the roller mark compositions for beef, lamb, sheep and goats. There we have it. In this roller mark, what we see there is the triple A is the H. The 000 is the fat code, and the ZWZ is the abattoir identification code. Every abattoir have a unique identification code, and for that reason, when we see a dollar mark in a butchery, we know exactly where from which abattoir is that carcass coming from. Loop a clot. Okay, let's go a little bit faster here. Pork, I'm not going to talk about pork here. trademarks. I just want to inform you that we have trademarks already, 26 registered with the National Department of Agriculture. That is where you have something like grass fed, grain fed, free range, etc. But we audit those trademarks from the farm to the display to ensure that the claim is valid. National carcass competitions, that's what it's all about today, a year actually, is where we do national carcass competitions in all 9 provinces. The aim of these competitions are to demonstrate to producers what market specifications and consumer requirements are. Market specifications and consumer requirements are to ensure optimal red meat production. Commercial as well as emergent farmers participate in these competitions respectively in their own leg against each other. My wish for you today, ladies and gentlemen, dream as if you're going to live forever and live as if you're going to die today. I thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, yes, I'm also going to do it for you in English, I think, and Afrikaans, both of them. But just to give you a bit of a background of what we look at when we start judging cattle. Just for interest's sake, we've got different points that we look at. But the main thing to think of is this 190 to 195. That is what the weight of the carcass is supposed to be to get maximum points. But I'm just going to go through the different points that Henny's going to show us now. Henny, if you look here, we've got different points that we actually measure. If you can just show them on the actual carcasses, where do we actually measure?
We start here right at the top. There's the first vertebrae, second, third, between the third and fourth one, 25 millimeters, which we normally measure with, we've got a small little instrument and you can use the vernier as well. We make a small incision there to be able to measure the fat. Then we count down 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 1/3. And this one is 50 millimeters. We make a small incision there so that we can measure the fat. Then it's 11, 12 1/2. And we make another incision there, 25 millimeters from the middle line. Bend it a bit open so we can measure it with a veneer.
Yes, any of them do that to each and every carcass, each and every side, and they get measured, and then obviously we put all the information into a computer. So it's not something that he can judge, it's a program that we actually use for that. There's just the different measuring points on a photo. If you can see the photo, that's the different points on the eye muscle that we actually look at. So it's very important to have the right build there. Conformation is very important, as Rudy was saying now as well, and I think a lot of your farmers here or people that have spoken today have said the same thing. We want broadness of the animal. We want broad shoulders and a decent chest in front. And that will normally be seen if you've got a decent broad head. You can see that animal will most probably be broad right through. So it's very important when we look at the animal, we'll look at the head as well. Not that we judge the head as such, but it gives us an indication of what that animal is going to look like right through. Another point that's very important for us, and it comes in where Rudy was talking about, is the fact that we want a 45 front part and about a 55 back part. If you take out the skin there. So if you take your finger and you take it out like that, you can see the four quarters 45 and hind quarters 55. Why do we want that? Because of the pistol grip that we talk about, like that. It's where all the very expensive cuts are, so it's important for us to grow that part of it. But if we look at all these bulls today, they are like that. I checked them, and they really look good. Different hump positions that we get in the Brahman, you find sometimes that the one hump will be a bit forward or backwards, and that can have a problem when it comes to the actual forward measurement. Any, maybe you can just explain to us that measurement.
Okay, in baie gevalle van die Brahmane, daar die ene wat ons daar het, het een redelijke rechtop skof. Hy gaan hier so sit, voorin toe. Maar dan krijg je Brahman wat die skof le half achter toe. Hy kom van daar voor en hy maak een hamp hier so. Dan krijg je rechtop hierdie meetpuntjie van ons. Pak hy vet aan. Hoor als dan waar een holpiekie is, moet hy volgemaak met vet. Ek kan sommer nou al vir julle wys welke van hulle daar uitkom. Kijk hier so. Hier is oorals ter naakte, dit is die eerste plek waar wees begin vet aan sit, is waar haar gaatje is om hom gelijk te kry. Hier so is die meeste vet op hierdie stadium aangepak, want dit is die diepste waar hy ingaat, hier in sy liester. En so gaan hy af, oorals ter waar hy holtiekie maak, maak hy vet. So die selfde gebeur, daar waar die skof aansluit, by die verbels hier op die rug, pak hy moet vet aan. En jylle kan sien selfs in hierdie geval hier rondom die rug, normaalweg as jy bees kyk, dan sê jy sien, hy het so even so'n holtiekie op die middel van sy rug. Daie holtiekies word gevul met vet. Dit is ook omdat meer vet lyk hier, as ek vir jou nabij gaan sny hier, dan gaan jy sien, die vet is een bietjie dikker, reg in die middel, as wat hy verder weg, en hoe verder hy weg, hoe minder word die vet. So dit is waar die Brahman tydje een probleem gee, as jy kry met die hangskof wat baie ver achter toe gaat, maar ek dink, ook as ons gaan kyk weer na lengte, as jy een langer lyf het, dan gaan die skof verder afkom en ons gaan nie in ons meetpunt sit op die vet.
Hier is net een foto van interessantheid om te wys specifiek waar daar so hump is, waar ons daar probleem het, wat ons nie met die ander het nie. Baie belangrik weer eens, wanneer ons kyk na een dier, is die breedte van die kop geef jou goeie indikasie. Ons neem daar keelvel uit in die voorkant om te sien of hy 45-55 is plus minus. En dan sprong van rib, wat allemaal van gepraat het vandag op die bille, is vir ons baie belangrik. The spring of rib shows us the depth of the animal. The bigger the spring of rib, the better the loins, the better the T-bones would be, and obviously the fillets at the back. So it's very important. Another point: when we judge cattle in a ring, we've sometimes got 20 or 30 of them in the ring, and they're all moving around. It's not like the animals that we've got here, so you've got to look at them at all kinds of angles. And one of the points that we look at is the actual tortoise muscle. Unfortunately, you can't see it very well there, but that tortoise muscle, the more prominent it is, the better the inside and outside thighs are. So it's very important for us when we're looking at the animal walking, we can actually see from the side if we've got full inside or outside thighs. And then as Rudy was saying, the rumps and obviously these loins are very, very important. And inner outer thighs is also important. Now, what happened was in the past, we were talking about 280 kilogram carcass as maximum weight for maximum points. Rudy has made it 295 now. And just for interest sake, we nearly got a hiding last year because of the fact that that extra 15 kgs put us into a better conformation from a 4 to a 5 and from a 5 to 5 plus, which meant that our slaughter percentage went up. So just in that 15 kilos from 280 to 295, we had a slaughter percentage difference from 60% to 64%. Now, if you take 4% on 15 kgs, it's tremendous, and it shows you conformation, what conformation can do for you if you just do that a little bit extra, and that can produce so much more beef. And that is what our main mission is. So you can even have a smaller animal, just conformation will give you a better slaughter percentage. And that's where the feedlot is making its money. Same differences, just in side views here. You can see this animal over here. It's about 52-48 at the back. You can see the hindquarters we're losing there. Well, that little Brahman is fine. If we look at this animal here, also fine. But we don't want that kind of flat animal. So that's a major, major problem, as Rudy was saying. We don't have the beef. We have a lot more bone. Hindquarters, very important. That's where expensive cuts are. So inner and outer thighs play a very big role. And when we look at hindquarters, just for an interest there, you can see there's a little ons praat van is opgesny hierso. The bigger the little triangle is at the back, and you guys can go and look at your bulls. If you see it cuts up quite high, it means you're going to have worse inner and outer thighs. If it smaller little triangle, fuller inner and outer thighs. And you can see it even with that one. That animal obviously is not the ideal because it's difficult for it to walk, but this is important. This is what we want to look at. And we're going to show it to you on the cattle now. Any just for interest sake, we've got these three carcasses here. This one actually won, but that was the best carcass there. Well, the only problem was it was an A3 plus fat for our carcass competitions, and we're very strict on that. So anyway, what I'm going to do is now I'm going to ask you to actually, I'm not going to go through, our time is a bit short, but please explain to us the differences between these two carcasses and what do you look at when you do the actual judging. Thank you.
Right, heel eerste gaan ons sommer begin by die vet. Daar is nie werklik 'n klasverskil tussen die twee beeste se vet nie. Dit is nie die ideale vet diktes vir 'n karkaskompetisie. Hulle is heeltemal te maar. Wanneer ons karkasse inskryf vir 'n karkaskompetisie, dan moet hy 'n ewerredige laagie vet hê, min of meer soos wat hierdie enetjie in hierdie omgewing lyk hierso. Nie bloukol hê nie. So dit is nie ideale ding, maar ons gaan nou die beste doen wat ons kan met dit wat ons hier in vir julle plekke wys en jy sê dit is hoe die hele karkas moet lyk en hoe hy moet lyk. Wanneer ons begin by vetbeoordeling, begin ons heel eerstens by die bout en dan sny ons die bout van hier af. Ons deel die karkas in drie gelyke dele, die bout, die rug en die voorkwart gedeelte. Dan gee ons 'n vetkode vir die bout. In hierdie een se geval, hierdie boutjie het maar bitter min vet op. Hy pak dik vet aan hier, hy pak dik vet aan hier in die binneboude. Die nate is toe, maar hy bly nog steeds 'n 2 minus vet. Wat nie vir jou ideaal is 'n 2 en 'n 2 plus vet. Om volpunte te kry, jy moet 5 punte kry as jy karkas kompetisie wil wen. En niemand skryf in om nie te wen nie. So die B-skoort heel wat vet daar. Dan kyk ons na die rugvetdikte. Dit is ook wat ons visueel met die oog nog beoordeel. Dit is nog voor ons by die metings kom. Kyk ons na hom. Hy is ook nog 'n bietjie aan die skraalkant. Hy beweeg meer na 2 vet toe as jy na die ruggedeelte kyk. En as ons die voorkwartjie vat, daar is bitter min vet aan hierdie voorkwart sigbaar. Nou, hy is nie ver weg van 'n 0 af nie, maar hy het nog daarmee 1 vet op die voorkwart. So in totaal sit ons hier met 'n karkas met 'n 1 plus 2 minus vetkode in die geheel, wat nie die ideaal is vir ons in 'n karkaskompetisie nie. Hy moet 'n ewerredige, die hele karkas moet, dit moet lyk of jy hom soos wat hy hierso lyk gesmeer het oor die hele karkas. Ons wil nie rooi kolle sien. Die oomblik as ons rooi kolle sien, dan begin jy 'n minus vet gee, en 'n minus vet beteken daar word 2 of 3 punte klaar afgetrek. Dit is wat die vet aan betref wat ons visueel met die oog sien. En ons vat hierdie vet en ons smeer dit nou oralster so oor en dan teken ek vir jou 'n prentjie van hoe die ding sou gelyk het met vet aan. Dieselfde is met hierdie karkas, bitter min vet, maar as ons dit klaar die drie dele vet opgesom en dan gee ons 'n totale karkas vet soos wat ons nou daarso ook gedoen het en met hierdie een dit sal in dieselfde klas val. En dan kom ons nou met ons meetinstrumentjie, die wineer. En ons meet fisies elke vetdiktetjie. En ons sit dit neer op die tabelletjie. Daai enetjie sit ons neer, daai enetjie sit ons neer. Dan het ons klaar gedoen met die vet. En ons gaan oor en ons gaan kyk na die bouvorm van die karkas. En dit is baie belangrik, want dit is een van die belangrikste goed. Jy kan vet met voer regmaak. Jy kan vir 'n beest vet aansit met voer. Met zilmaks kan jy die bouvorm 'n bietjie verbeter. Maar jy kan nie 'n ding wat die genetiese vermoë het van hierdie ding met zilmaks gaan vat na 5 plus bouvorm. Dis onmoontlik. Jy gaan hom 'n beter bouvorm kan kry na 4 toe miskien, maar ek twyfel ook of jy hom heeltemal na 4 goeie 4 bouvorm gaan kry. Jy gaan hom 'n bietjie beter kan maak met zilmaks, maar dit is dit. Jy gaan vir jou 'n bietjie voordeel kry wanneer jy hom gaan slag, maar teeling baie belangrik. Wanneer ons bouvorms begin beoordeel, kom ons vat hom van bo af. Melkom het ek klink vir my, jy het al lewendige beeste gekyk hierso en jy het gekyk na die breedte van die karkas tussen die heupbene. As ons hierdie enetjie daar by mekaar gaan sit, dan kan julle sien. Heel eers wil ek julle vra, watter een van hierdie twee lyk vir julle die beter? die een aan die rechterkant. So allemaal kan zien waarvan ons praat, nee? Right, heel eerste, dan kijken we hier zo so naar die breedte van die karkas. Welke met vele beduie aan dakkige kruis wat jy krijgt. Als daar een so lyk, dan gaan jy nie een ramp en jy gaan een platter dingetje. Jy het nie buite duie op hierdie karkas. Ons wil jy moet van hier af naar die haak toe met hierdie karkas rond uitkom. In hierdie geval is hy baie plat, daai kant ook, hy loop maar reguit op. As jy hom vergelyk met hierdie ene, hier begint ons ronding kry. Maar nog nie werkelijk nie, nee? Dit is maar so even so meer, bietjie wat hy begin uitdui daar van die ramp af. Hier val hy weer weg, en dan maak hy so even so rondingkie, maar nog nie ideaal wat ons wil hier nie. Ons wil hy moet rechtaf waar rond uitkom, om hom 5 plus of 4 bouw vir hom te gee. Beide van hierdie en daarin is 'n 3 minus bouw vir hom, hierdie en sal net 'n 3 plus bouw vir hom. Maar in gewone klassifikasie val hulle in dieselfde knas. Hier kan julle sien die verskil ook achter wat Welkom nou nog gewys het. Ons wil hê hy moet vandaar van die haak af moet hy lekker rond uitkom hier naartoe. Hierdie ene begin, hy wys al effens 'n ronde, maar as ek hom vir julle dwars draai en julle kyk van so af, dan is dit maar 'n reguit lyn. So nog laat nie 'n goeie ene nie. As julle hom vergelyk met hierdie enetjie, hierdie ene maak nie net 'n reguit lyn nie, hy maak 'n induik na binnenkant toe. En dit kon julle allemaal sien. Dit is hoekom julle gesê daarin is beter as hierdie ene. So daar so val hy heeltemal weg, aan die buitenkant val hy weg. Hierdie binnenduie, daai driehoekie wat Melkom gewys het, jy kan het so duidelik sien aan die karkas ook. Ek vat hom nou vir julle daar teen mekaar druk, dan kan julle sien daar. Kyk hoe hoog kom hierdie ding op. Lang driehoek wat daar so is. Nee, daar is niks. Hier is niks binnenduie daar so nie. Kyk maar daar, hy val heeltemal weg. Hierdie kant val hy ook weg. Ek gaan nou die ander een omdraai en dan gaan ek vir julle wys aan hierdie binnenboutjies. Daar begint hy daarin al, sien jy, daar is maar een bietjie vleis. Daar is wat jy bietjie meer vleis wat daar uitkom, daar kan jy dit sien. So hierdie ene bietjie beter. Dan gaan ons oor na die lende toe, ons het nou die ramp en die buitenduie, die binnenduie, die veetje wat Melkom gepraat het, die skilpadspier wat hier so sit as hy loop, dan sien jy hom. Ek wil net weer julle aandag vestig, kyk mooi na die nate, as Melkom net gepraat van die lewende gebeeste, gaan julle dit daal kan sien. Dan gaan ons oor na die lende toe. Hou vir hom is nie net in die bouwriet nie, baie mense maak die fout en dink as hy 'n verskriklike paar bouwriet in hierdie beest, nou het hy 'n ding met 'n vyf bou vir hom, dit is glad nie die geval. Soos Rudy net te verduidelik het, jou T-bank sal goed sit hier. Uit hierdie beestie uit gaan jy 'n T-bank hier kry, wat so lekker groot stuk beer het, so klein stukkie vleis gaan hê. Uit hierdie een gaan jy 'n beter T-bank uit kry, hy is 'n bietjie breër, daar kan julle sien vandag, ons wil graag hê, En wanneer jy 4 en 5 bou vir my, dan kom hierdie gedeelte van hier af, maak jy al rond, die sprong van rug, trek hierdie, laat hy baie breer raak, oor jou lende, hier waar jou T-bone sit. Julle sien al twee, hierdie ene loop skuins af, daai gaan toe, hierdie ene wil begin so uitkom, nog nie sterk genoeg vir ons om een goeie punt te kan gee. As ons vorentoe gaan, jou oogspier moet deurloop, tot hier, onder die blaaie in. Hier so is een voorbeeld van dit, wat hy is beter, jy kan dit baie duidelik sien, baie beter, hy kom uit, maar nog steeds baie swak. Hierdie karkas, hoewel hy hier vanaf op beter lyk, nee, hier van voor af, van hier af, is daar niks, daar het niks gebeur, en hy wegraak tussen sy blaai. Het hy net verander in een nek, geen skouers wat rarig uitstaan nie, daai oogspier wat van hier af moet deurkom, en dan sien hy baie in die karkas, hier so kom hy nie so gelijk in nie, hy maak een bochel wat hy hier oorkom, en hy gaan so oor, en dan het jy die skouerspiere wat daar so uitstaan. Die kan jy baie duidelik sien, en ek gaan nou vir julle wys, wanneer die beer staan, hoe kan jy dit ook sien, behalwe dat jy bo op die rug die karkas van vooraf kyk, en jy sien hierdie een loop spits na voren toe, hy is nog baie erger as die ander, hier so is niks hier so nie, hy het heeltemal verdwyn. Hy is nog slechter as daai, maar ek gaat hulle nou vir julle omdraai, want op die lewendige wees, as jy dit nie van bo af kan sien, op die wees rug staan, as jy hoog genoeg is nie, dan kan jy kyk na die voorbene wat Melkom al vir julle beduie het, ergste waar die wees te staan, waar jy moet kyk, die breedte tussen die skouer knoppe. En as jy hierdie ding gaan omdraai, en dit is nou ongelukkig, gaan hy nou verkeerd omwees, maar ek wil net vir julle wys, kyk na die breedte van die borsie wat hier so is, hier so is niks. En dan vergelijk julle met die ding wat allemaal kon sien, wat al klaar beter lyk. Hier so het jy daarom een beetje van een breer bors. Kyk na die breedte wat jy hier so het, van die been af daar na die middel toe. Daarom so'n beetje beter as die ding. So as jy dit nog breër of beter het in die lewendige wees, kan jy dit sien, en hoe breër hy gaan wees, hoe breër gaan jou bors wees, hoe breër jou bors gaan wees, hoe breër gaan jou bespiering wees tussen die skouers. Hierso is nou niks, want dit is, jy het twee skouerblaaie wat hier is, en die spiere loop sommer so reg uit af binne gaan. Belangrik ook om te kyk na die nek, daar moet daar 'n bietjie vleis aan die nek op wees, dit is nog deel van die karkas. As die ding sy nekkie so dun is, en die kopie is klein, dan is daar nie 'n bouvorm, dit sluit alles aan by die lewendige wees. Julle kan maar gaan kyk, die ding wat 'n klein kopie en 'n platterige nekkie het, nee, gaan definitief nie bespiering hier tussen die skouers aan te sien. So dit is al die punte waarna ons kyk vir die bouvorm. Begin maar bo by die bout, werk om af deur die lende, en in sommige gevalle dan kry ons regtig waar wat jy sit met 'n 5 boutgedeelte en jy sit met 'n 5 lende en dan val hy weg hiervoor. Dan sit jy met 'n 4. Dan kan ons mos nou nie vir daai bees gaan 'n 5 bouvorm gee nie, dan word hy 4 plus, wat beteken jy gaan nou in steede van 19, 20 punte kon gekry het, kry nou net 15 punte. Die oomblik as hy 4 raak, verloor hy al die punte en hy val na 5. Karkasse soos hierdie wat net 'n 3 bouvormpie het, hierdie een skaarse 3 bouvorm het, is net 'n 10 punte werd. So 10 punte verloor as gevolg van bouvorm, en bouvorm word grotendeels bepaal deur die tipe bil wat jy gebruik. Maak nie saak in watter ras nie. Daar is verskillende rasse wat al die nasionale kompetisie gewen het. So in die ras moet jy seker maak dat jy die beste bil het en dat jy 'n bil het wat vir jou vleis eienskappe gaan gee, en as hy swak punte het, laat hy dalk wegval op die skouers, dan moet jy wegkom van dit af en iets anders verkry. En as jy 'n bil het wat vir jou sulke kalas gee soos hierdie op die einde van die dag, dan moet jy heeltemal wegkom van dit. Want selfs in jou gewone bemarking, in die kompetisie is dit belangrik om 'n goeie ding te hê om te kan wen, maar in jou elke dag se toestande, jou boerdery is jou besigheid, dis jou werk, soos ek en Melkom 'n werk het waarvoor ons betaal het, hierdie is jou inkomste, en as jy moet 'n eenheid wat jy op die plaas dra, kan 200, 300, 400 rand meer inkry, net deur beter kalf op die einde van die dag te speen, en 'n beter karkas uit te slag, dan gaan jy daai ekstra geld kry. So dit is in elke ou se eie belang om te kyk na daai ding en te selekteer waar hy swak punte het as hy gaan wil koop om 'n beter bil te kry. Net vir die interessantheid, vir die gewone klassifikasie het ons altyd begin by die ouderdom. Hierdie kom van abattoirs af wat nie klassifiseer nie, so hulle het nie nodig om die tande te gaan tel nie, want hulle verkoop net beesvleis. Hulle verkoop nie A-klas, C-klas beesvleis nie. Hoe gaan ek op die einde van die dag bepaal of hierdie ding nou A was of nie? Ons kyk maar na die kleur van die bene, die sagtheid van die bene. Hoe jonger die dier is, bene is vol bloed, hierdie kraakbeentjie is sag, ek het met my mes soveel kan rondeer sny. Selfde is met hierdie enetjie hierso, jy kan dwars deur die beentjie gaan sny met die knipmes. Hoe ouer hy word, hoe harder raak hierdie bene, hierdie kraakbene wat hier bo in raak, gekalsifiseer en hy raak weg op die einde van die dag. Dan verder, hierdie enetjie was 'n vers. Hoe sien ons dit? Daar is gewoonlik, as dit 'n os of 'n bil is daar 'n klein spiertjie waar die teens vas geheg word, want dit is belangrik wanneer ons karkasse klassifiseer, om te weet of dit 'n bil of 'n os of 'n koei of 'n wat ook al gewees het, veral in die ouer klasse. En kom ons kyk net wat is hierdie enetjie. Hierdie was ook 'n vers. En ongelukkig is die vet aan die binnekant afgesny, maar as julle sou gekyk het, sou hy 'n gladde vet soos hierso gehad het, wanneer dit 'n os is, want hy sulke trossies vet wat hy daar aanpak. Welke enige ietsie wat jy wou gehad het, ek nog kan noem rondom die vet en bouvorm beoordeling?
Nee, dankie, nee, ek dink is dit, kom ons gee die man 'n goeie hand, hy het behoorlik gedoen. Ons gaan nou net buite toe beweeg, hulle gaan vir ons paar billetjies bring, dan kan ons net hulle aan die lewendige kant bespreek, dankie.